I'd like to welcome you to the Montana State University Library's Trout and Salmon Lecture Series. My name is Kenny Arledge, and I am the Dean of the MSU Library. Thank you for coming tonight, and thank you to our host, the Museum of the Rockies. The Trout and Salmon Collection, held in the library's special collections, has grown into one of the largest and most valuable sources for research on fish and fishing. And we have Bud Lilly and former Dean of the Library, Bruce Morton, to thank for their vision and efforts in creating this world-class collection. Bud Lilly is a legend in fishing circles, and he's here with us tonight. Bud, will you give us a wave? Expresses appreciation for our natural environment. In the spirit of that appreciation, the MSU Library launched the Acoustic Atlas in October. And as you might guess, there's overlap between this project and the Trout and Salmon Collection. The Acoustic Atlas is an effort to collect and make accessible to the world some of the sounds of our natural environment. Birds, animals, wind in trees, water tumbling over rocks, ice thawing, and yes, even the sounds of fly fishing will be a part of the Acoustic Atlas. But there's even more. We plan to record the voices of Bud Lilly and other guides as they tell the stories of the fishing trips they took, the people they guided, the places they went, and how those places have changed over half a century. The Acoustic Atlas is live, but still small, at acousticatlas.org. But stay tuned, we're growing and there's much more to come. I invite you to go visit our display table out front, and Molly Anderson is out there with headphones, and you can actually listen to some of the sounds that we've collected already. Tonight we are honored to have as our guest Dan Wink, Superintendent of Yellowstone National Park. We normally pay our speakers an honorarium, but Dan has asked that we donate that honorarium to the Yellowstone Park Foundation. So we will be making that donation in his name after this lecture. We want to make sure he talks first. But I'm not here to introduce Dan Wink. That's not my job tonight. That I will leave to Paul Scholeri. Paul is an accomplished author, having written dozens of books on fishing, bears, wolves, Yellowstone and Glacier National Parks, and often collaborating with his wife, the artist Marcia Carley. We're proud to call Paul our scholar in residence at the MSU Library. Please welcome Paul Scholeri.
Thank you, Kenny. And thanks to your terrific team for putting on this event. The Trout and Salmon Collection sponsors something very special with this lecture series. It's brought some of the most distinguished and thoughtful voices from the world of trout to our community. Bozeman's a great trout town, and we're more blessed than most other trout towns because of this collection and all the things it can do for us. And we're blessed because we have Yellowstone nearby. For more than 140 years, Yellowstone has been bringing millions of people great joys and satisfactions. Wilderness lovers, wildlife watchers, anglers, and a host of other nature enthusiasts have found enrichment and fulfillment in the park's beautiful landscapes. Simultaneously, Yellowstone has been at the center of many important conversations, debates, and controversies, not merely about how Yellowstone itself should be managed, but about our greater relationship with nature. We are constantly in a state of coming to terms with Yellowstone and what it means. And that's what makes it so exciting to have Yellowstone Superintendent Dan Wink here. His office, if you can imagine this. His office is where all of America's passions and hopes, separate realities, and other strong feelings about Yellowstone collide, and where they must be faced. It's also where more than a century's accumulation of park policy and law must be honored. Whatever I've learned in 40 years of researching, discussing, and writing about Yellowstone would feel hollow and insufficient had it not been illuminated by my exposure to the perspectives of several Yellowstone superintendents. No one else has or can have their take on things. They have to get close enough to Yellowstone to understand its most subtle nuances, and yet they have to stand far enough back to comprehend its complex role in the modern world. Dan Wink brings to this assignment the seasoning of a remarkable career in the parks, which is described in the programs you've all received. Among the things he accomplished before he arrived in Yellowstone, I want to elaborate on only one, and that happened during his years as superintendent of Mount Rushmore. And I will just say that we are all indebted to Dan for his brilliant transformation of the visitor experience at that great national shrine. Dan also brings other credentials that are essential in a Yellowstone superintendent. These include his own passion for the parks, a durable sense of humor, and judging from the boxes of dry flies that I've seen scattered around his house, a pretty serious enthusiasm for Yellowstone's trout, about which he will now speak. Please welcome Yellowstone Superintendent Dan Wink.
Lecture Series and Mr. Jane Thule for the invitation to speak with you tonight. It's been my pleasure to be the superintendent of Yellowstone for the past 3 years. During my time back in the park, I've been reminded that everything you do in Yellowstone National Park is controversial. There was about a week in my very first year back that I thought the only thing that wasn't controversial was native fish conservation. I was wrong. I have learned that every fish species, native or non-native, has advocates. Advocating for fish or for sport fishing is not necessarily advocating for national parks or protection of these great places. But none of those advocates for non-native species are required to manage a park under the same requirements of the staff of Yellowstone. The management policies are very straightforward. They state that all exotic plant and animal species that are not maintained to meet specific park purposes will be managed, up to and including eradication, if first of all, control is prudent and feasible, and second, the exotic species interferes with natural processes and the perpetuation of natural features. Native species or natural habitat or disrupts the genetic integrity of the native species. Furthermore, the management policies provide a decision framework for initiating exotic species management. For species determined to be exotic or where management appears to be feasible and effective, superintendents should evaluate the species' current or potential impact on park resources, develop and implement exotic species plans, according to established planning procedures, and consult as appropriate with federal, tribal, local, state agencies, as well as other interest groups. And four, public review and comment where appropriate. I mention all of this because I wanted to set the framework for what we're doing with native fish conservation in Yellowstone. I think you'll find that the actions that we have taken are consistent with the policies of the National Park Service. If we only had to manage national parks for one set of values, either preservation of natural systems or alternatively for the benefit and enjoyment of the people, life would be easy, but we get to do both. Values in conflict is the arena that most issues play out in Yellowstone and the National Park Service. I see many former and some current employees of Yellowstone in the room tonight, and I believe they join me in placing the preservation and protection of Yellowstone as the highest priority so that they may be enjoyed unimpaired for future generations. When I was asked to speak, I commented to Mr. Thule and Mr. Schilleri that you really need an expert in the fisheries of Yellowstone. I'm just the superintendent. I suggested a few names, Dr. Todd Kuhl, or our fisheries biologist, or Dave Hallett, the head of the Yellowstone Center for Resources. And he's also an incredibly avid fisherman. But they assured me they wanted an understanding of the superintendent's perspective on conservation in the park, so that's what you're going to get. My association with Yellowstone goes back to 1979, when I arrived as a very naive landscape architect. But my education came quickly, through Superintendent John Townsley, who recruited me, to Superintendent Bob Barbie, who inherited me. For a time, I shared offices with the Park Research Branch, and I got introduced to the practice of resource management and the protection and preservation of natural systems, probably the greatest learning experience of my life. And then I got to come back in 2011 and fix some of the mistakes I made in the early 80s. So let's talk about native fisheries and native fish conservation from my perspective. Despite the years of occupation of Yellowstone for thousands of years by Native Americans, there is really no written documentation of what the park and the waters were like. This documentation came with some of the early Euro-American explorers in the 1800s. Mountain men of the time often visited the park and saw its unique features, including Yellowstone Lake. Reports by these wanderers led to formal surveys. John Coulter of the Lewis and Clark expedition visited Yellowstone in the winter of 1806 and 1807. From notes and journals of these formal surveys, we see reference to the richness of wildlife, including reference to its fishes. These accounts of travel in Yellowstone give us a glimpse of the park's condition just prior to its formal establishment in 1872. A member of the Hayden Survey, William Jackson, was a photographer and provided us with the first images of Yellowstone. This may not be one of his best portraits, but do show members of that survey on the lake in a boat that came to Anna in 1871. In 1883, we see a very clear message by the managers of Yellowstone in regard to the difference of the treatment of fish and wildlife. The hunting mammals and birds, except predators, was prohibited. But fishing was not. This was a significant turning point for national parks, as fishing was considered to be an acceptable practice at parks throughout the country. Poaching of the game and fish was so bad in Yellowstone that the U.S. Army was sent in. And in 1886, to curtail poaching and maintain order in the park. The captains of the Army at the time also served as acting superintendents for the park. In 1889, Captain Buttel was an avid fisherman and requested that the newly formed U.S. Fish Commission investigate Yellowstone waters for possible improvements. Quite quickly, David Starr Jordan visited Yellowstone in September and October of 1889 and developed the first distribution map of Yellowstone fishes. With amazing detail, Jordan was able to map the original fishless area, which was about 40% of the park, represented here by the highlighted line by red arrows, primarily on the western side of the park. Early managers thought the fishless condition of the park waters was due to toxic effects of the chemicals in the warm waters produced by the hot springs. Later, it was realized that fish were absent because stream channel barriers posed by waterfalls. Even though the fishing at the dawn of Yellowstone was outstanding, early managers saw a need to make it better. At the time, these fishless waters were not acceptable, and the newly formed Fish Commission jumped at the chance to stock fishes and develop a sport fishery throughout the park. The goal of park managers was to have the best possible sport fishing in as many waters as could be reasonably be stocked. In 1889 marked the beginning of a long history of non-native fish introductions to Yellowstone. As brook trout were planted in the fishless upper waters of the Firehole and the Garden Rivers, rainbow trout were planted in the upper Gibbon River, and within a few years, lake trout and ground trout were introduced to the Lewis and Shoshone Lakes. This put-and-take mentality became a way of doing business in Yellowstone. because eventually this mentality existed for over 50 years. And so it was done. Hatchery operations were established in Yellowstone, and fisheries operations began to a grand expansion to improve nature. Beginning in 1901, the operations of Yellowstone were supervised by Mr. D.C. Booth of the Spearfish, South Dakota National Fish Hatchery. This image is one of the expeditions to Lake Yellowstone from Spearfish. Looking closely, you can see the boat on a wagon to be used to access remote streams on Yellowstone Lake. The fisheries resources of Yellowstone existed for the good of the people. In his report in 1895, Superintendent Anderson stated that the enormous number of lake trout taken here by all parties who take the time to cast the line surpasses all belief. Regardless, fishes were throughout the park. And by 1902, Yellowstone had received all the species of sportfish that exist today. At the turn of the century, and the establishment of seasonal hatchery operations in Yellowstone, the park also began to see increases in visitation and improved visitor services. The abundance of Yellowstone cutthroat trout was quickly known nationwide through constant publication. This publicity led to increased pressure by visitors. Ironically, it's the abundance of cutthroat trout here that eventually caused their decline. As more and more parks and national monuments were added across the country, there came a need for a central office to administer them and provide support. In 1916, after 30 years of management by the U.S. Army, Yellowstone management was within the National Park Service. The Act of 1960 called for the conservation of the scenery and the natural and historic objects and the wildlife therein, and to provide for the enjoyment of such and of the same in such manner and by such means as will leave them unimpaired for future generations. This act, for the first time, put natural resources and wildlife on equal ground with enjoyment and public use. We began to see direction for Yellowstone, but also a major dilemma in that we were mandated to conserve and to use. Throughout all of this, it's clear what prevails is a near agricultural philosophy of stewardship as continuously put forward by the managers of Yellowstone. In 1922, fish were planted, elk were harvested, bison were ranched, bears were fed, and predators were killed. And through it all, Yellowstone became the largest single source of wild cutthroat trout eggs in the United States. And of course, unfortunately, it wasn't realized that these fish, despite their great abundance in Yellowstone Lake and many streams, were not well suited for most areas that they were stocked. They were not adapted and cannot survive while in competition and under predation pressure by other fishes. So much of this effort was in vain. This image is of the U.S. Bureau of Fisheries truck leaving Yellowstone for Homer, Minnesota Station in 1925. It's now clear that the management actions initially of the U.S. Army and later the National Park Service had and are having profound ecological consequences. The indiscriminate stocking of non-natives has resulted in the displacement of intolerant natives such as West Slope cutthroat trout and grayling, hybridization of Yellowstone and West Slope cutthroat trout with non-native rainbow trout, competition and predation of the Yellowstone cutthroat trout by non-native lake trout. And there is evidence suggests that the stocked fishes in historically fishless waters has led to localized extinction of sensitive amphibians and other species. Despite the fact that the magnitude of manpower and facilities and wholesale export of gannets and fish was huge, the effort was small compared to what it will take to reverse these actions. To me, the period of 1889, when the first brook, brown, rainbow, and lake trout arrived, to 1957, when stocking stopped, is a period of ecological destruction for the fisheries of Yellowstone. Although it was really by this time too late for Yellowstone, the National Park Service developed the first stocking policy in 1936, which stated that non-native fish shall not be stocked in the waters containing native fish. Propagation and stocking of native species shall not be encouraged. Distribution of non-native species should not be expanded. No artificial lake or stream improvements shall be made, and selected waters should be left barren of fish. At the time, in 1936, fisheries professionals, for the most part, considered this to be radical thinking. To fishermen, these must have seemed weird. More fish is always better than any specific kind of fish, right? These ideas are somewhat revolutionary. Not only will no non-natives be stocked, but hatchery propagation of baby fish was discouraged, and many visit waters were to be left fishless. The National Park Service fish stocking policies were formally published in the Transactions of the American Fisheries Society in 1937 by David Madsen, the supervisor of fish resources for the National Park Service. However, for Yellowstone National Park, much of the damage had already been done by 1937. We can demonstrate this here. More than 400 kilometers of Yellowstone's larger streams and rivers originally supported native fish. However, stocking the park waters with non-native rainbow brook and brown trout has impacted most of these streams. Subsequent invasion by headwater streams by non-natives resulted in additional significant loss. Currently, less than 50 kilometers of Yellowstone's large streams and rivers contain native fish only. Non-native fish were stocked in streams and rivers containing native cutthroat trout. In many places, the native cutthroat trout were completely extirpated. An example of where this has happened is the Madison River, where non-native brown and rainbow trout have completely displaced native West Slope cutthroat trout and fluvial Arctic grayling. Non-native fish were also stocked in waters that were originally naturally fishless. Because of this, today there are a greater number of streams supported by non-native rainbow brook and or brown trout than there were historically supporting natives. It was by the early mid-1960s the realization occurred that only a large, healthy fish population, in particular the cutthroat trout population of Yellowstone Lake, could play its important ecological role as a food source for dozens of other species of animals. Fish were slowly rising to the park's management's esteem. At the same time, fish populations were embarrassingly and alarmingly low from years of abuse. The Leopold Report in 1963 redefined park resource management. The report called for the biotic associations within each park to be maintained and, where necessary, recreated as nearly as possible in the condition that prevailed when the area was first visited by white people. Currently, native fish in Yellowstone are conserved to reduce the risk of extinction, restore and maintain their important ecological role, and to create sustainable angling and viewing opportunities. Native fish conservation efforts are focused on Yellowstone Lake, and this received much attention. However, a significant amount of work is being done to preserve and restore native fish in several other areas of the park, including the Gallatin and Madison drainages along the park's west side and the Lamar River drainage in the northern range. The Yellowstone Lake drainage above the upper falls of Canyon represents the largest remaining undisturbed habitat for genetically pure Yellowstone cutthroat trout in existence. Cutthroat trout in this area are highly valued ecologically, economically, and socially. They're a valuable food source for several species of birds and mammals, including grizzly bears, otters, eagles, white pelicans, osprey. Cutthroat trout are the basis for an extensive sport fishing economy in communities surrounding Yellowstone, with anglers coming from all over the world to fish for these wild native fish. Lake trout were discovered in the Yellowstone Lake in 1994. They are highly predatory, and in other lakes in the western United States where they've been introduced, cutthroat trout have been virtually eliminated. In 1995, a panel of fisheries experts projected that without control of lake trout in Yellowstone Lake, native cutthroat trout would be reduced to a mere fraction of historical levels or functionally eliminated. However, with effective suppression, cutthroat trout could be maintained at a population size which would sustain the ecological integrity of the Since lake trout dwell in deep waters, they are not available as prey for most mammals and birds. Allowing lake trout to replace cutthroat trout in Yellowstone Lake would have severe consequences in the overall status of Yellowstone cutthroat trout subspecies, the Yellowstone Lake ecosystem, and the sport fishery. Although National Park Service began ill-vetting to remove lake trout soon after they were discovered, in 1994, catches of lake trout and the overall effort to remove them have dramatically increased over time. Currently, the Yellowstone cutthroat trout population has declined in Yellowstone Lake. Estimates that I received when arriving in the park indicated that the populations had dropped from almost 4 million cutthroat trout to under 500,000. We are working now to get better estimates, but the order of magnitude was startling. Animals in the Yellowstone Lake ecosystem, which have relied on the cutthroat trout as a food source, have been displaced by the decline. Ecological implications of cutthroat trout decline include displacement of osprey. Ospreys, which are oligopiscivores, meaning they eat fish almost exclusively, have declined dramatically around Yellowstone Lake. A decade ago, there were 50 or more nesting osprey pairs around the lake. Today, there are only 4 or 5 nests per year. Success of these nests is limited, and we are currently studying the raptors in Yellowstone to gain more knowledge and insight to what is happening. Grizzly bears, once fed on cutthroat trout in the shallow tributaries around Yellowstone Lake during the cutthroat trout spring spawning migration. Visual surveys of a dozen cutthroat spawning streams between Lake and Grant have been conducted annually. In the late 1980s, it was not uncommon for 70 or more cutthroat trout to be seen each week in these spawning streams. In recent years, the survey crew is lucky to find a spawning cutthroat trout. Grizzly bear use of these same spawning streams has also declined over the same period, the 80s to the present. The trend in grizzly bear mirrors that of cutthroat trout with a 1 to 2 year lag, suggesting a learned behavior by the bears in among years. Recently, Arthur Middleton, a PhD graduate of the University of Wyoming, has published a paper related to cutthroat trout decline. Middleton and others, including Yellowstone staff, have brought out a hypothesis regarding ecological linkages between lake trout, cutthroat trout, grizzly bears, and migratory elk. You can see in this slide that the northern and Cody herds migrate to areas near Yellowstone Lake. There is some evidence to suggest that grizzly bears have switched their diets from cutthroat trout to elk calves in the lake area. It is possible that lake trout may indirectly affect migratory elk in the greater Yellowstone ecosystem. So what do? We began the environmental assessment process for native fish conservation in 2010. The native fish conservation plan has 3 objectives: reduce the long-term extinction risk for native fish, restore and maintain the important ecological role for native fish, create and sustain native angling and fish viewing opportunities. This plan had received a great deal of public support from the 3,000 pieces of correspondence containing over 10,000 individual comments. We approved an approved FONSI, finding of no significant impact, was signed in May of 2011. And the focus of the plan was on both restoring Yellowstone cutthroat trout in Yellowstone Lake, meaning through suppression netting, and focused on Yellowstone cutthroat trout, West Slope cutthroat trout in grayling restoration in their native ranges throughout the rest of the park. We've had several reviews by subject matter experts. Currently conduct annual science panel reviews to the ongoing lake trout suppression, Yellowstone cutthroat trout restoration project on Yellowstone Lake, which is an outside check to assure that we're moving in the right direction. Panel members are nationally renowned scientists with specialties in either lake trout, cutthroat trout, or population ecology biology. This effort is led by Dr. Robert Breswell, research biologist with the U.S. Geological Service here in Bozeman. The park has forged a productive partnership with the Greater Yellowstone Coalition. National Park and Conservation Association, Trout Unlimited, Idaho, Trout Unlimited Montana, Trout Unlimited Wyoming, Yellowstone Park Foundation, and collaborating scientists to implement components of the plan. Our efforts contribute to the collaborative work of the Yellowstone Cutthroat Trout and Interstate Work Group, Montana Cutthroat Trout Steering Committee, and the Fluvial Arctic Grayling Work Group, all of which are composed of state, federal, and tribal fisheries professionals throughout the region. This requires a lot of money. We're spending over $2 million per year on these projects. The Yellowstone Park Foundation is trying to raise the bulk of the funds for the main suppression contract on Yellowstone Lake. They have raised and are committed to raising $1 million per year to implement this effort. Non-governmental organizations are working hard to raise funds for an ongoing research. In fact, a piece of legislation has made its way through both houses of the Wyoming legislature and awaiting the governor's signature that will approve over $600,000 to advance the methods of lake trout suppression. These funds will go to the Wyoming Council of Trout Unlimited. Yellowstone also contributes over $1 million a year through base funds and funds we generate through entrance fees. The largest lake trout caught in 2009 by fisheries crew was 26 pounds, 4 ounces. This is it. The current record is over 33 pounds caught in 2012. Lake trout live a long time. The oldest on record is 62 years. This trout was not aged, so I can't tell you how old it was. Let's talk about what we're doing on the lake. Please understand, with current technology, we don't believe we can eliminate lake trout from Yellowstone Lake, but we do believe that we can drive the population down to a manageable level. So therefore, we're not only looking at lake trout suppression, but also monitoring and adaptive management and applied research for the long-term efforts that will be required. We've been increasing suppression efforts over the last few years. We've cobbled together a major effort for the first time in 2011, enlisting the assistance of the Yellowstone Park Foundation for funding, and now we've been able to meet the targets established by the science panel. Last year, contract crews ran 3 large boats, and the National Park Service ran a boat. In 2012, we had over 62,200 units of netting effort was achieved, well over the science panel's recommendation. Large trap nets, with traps that are 40 by 30 by 20, with leads up to 900 feet, have been used in recent years. Fish caught in these traps remain alive, healthy, with little stress. Yellowstone cutthroat trout caught can be released unharmed. Traps can be fished in shallow water where there are large numbers of Yellowstone cutthroat trout mixed in with the lake trout. Lake trout captured via traps makes excellent research candidates for stress and health, low stress, and they're very healthy. Over 1.4 million lake trout have been removed since the start of the program. Over 825,000 lake trout in just the last 3 years. Increased numbers are due in part to increased effort. However, lake trout are becoming harder to catch, which is a great sign. We have 2 main monitoring programs, random site selection lake-wide and multitude of mesh sizes. We're beginning to see an increase in the numbers of Yellowstone cutthroat trout. Here you can see what the population looked like in the distribution netting we did in 2011, the first year of the large effort on the lake. You can see a strong increase in the number of juvenile Yellowstone cutthroat trout in 2012. And with the same effort, we caught more fish. Beginning to see some juveniles move up into larger class sizes, indications of more recruitment of juvenile fish, and once again, more fish. Hopefully, we'll see more of these fish moving to spawning tributaries in the next 1 to 2 years. All are positive signs that our efforts on the lake are paying dividends. As I said, we understand the current methods are time-consuming, costly, and therefore we need to find other methods that can contribute to the control of lake trout. We hope to develop methods which can target eggs and embryos before they move from the spawning sites. We're looking for what we can do for allow reduction in suppression netting. allow reduction of the nation of the lake trout population by reducing the recruitment juveniles to the population and by reducing reproductive potential, in other words, removing the adults from the population. We have a lake trout telemetry study. We have embedded 5 devices, I believe, in over 200 lake trout to detect their movements throughout the lake, to pinpoint where the trout are spawning in order to apply alternative methods in developing eggs, methods to developing eggs and embryos. Also, the lake trout detect movement corridors and congregations to more effectively target adults in the netting. That's Carrington Island, obviously a very heavily used spawning site within the park. Alternative methods currently being explored are suction. Oops, I'm sorry. Each female trout can have up to 1,000s of eggs. I've been told that lake trout can have up to 1,000 eggs for each pound of adult weight. I understand that not all eggs will become fertilized and not all fertilized eggs will become fry, but this does demonstrate the magnitude of the problem, showing just the eggs from one adult fish. Alternative methods currently being explored are suction or dredging to remove eggs from the substrate, as a technique we'll be experimenting with this summer. Electricity has proved to be effective at killing developing embryos, but we need to develop a method to get the electricity down into the substrate where they reside. MSU researchers have had encouraging results along the path which we will try this fall. They are beautiful fish. Let's move from Yellowstone cutthroat trout and Yellowstone Lake to some river and stream restoration, like Arctic Grayling and the Grayling Creek. This map shows the current status of both Yellowstone and West Slope cutthroat trout across Yellowstone National Park. In the yellow areas, we have found hybridized Yellowstone cutthroat and West Slope cutthroat trout. Areas of blue remain genetically pure, or we not yet detected any hybridized fish. Red are areas where these fish are gone, and the gray represents originally fishless areas of the park. In here, historic distribution of genetically pure Yellowstone cutthroat trout in the Lamar River. In the 1930s, early stages of rainbow trout expansion into the Lamar River drainage. The first official stocking of rainbow trout in Lamar River drainage occurred at Sodebute Creek in 1937. Over 105,000 fish weighing about 1.5 pounds. The first and only stocking of the Lamar River occurred in 1938 with 70,000 advanced stage fry. In 2002, rainbow trout confirmed in the first meadow of Slough Creek. Historically, it was believed that a small cascade downstream of the first meadow of Slough Creek was a barrier to upstream fish migration, protecting the stream from rainbow trout invasion. In 2006, rainbow trout genetics detected fish testing above Icebox Canyon in Sodebute Creek. Brook trout are also located in Sodebute Creek above the falls in Icebox Canyon, which was originally believed to be a barrier to upstream fish migration. 2007, rainbow trout and the Yellowstone cutthroat trout, rainbow trout hybrids confirmed in the second meadow of Slough Creek. 2008, rainbow trout and Yellowstone cutthroat trout, rainbow trout hybrids confirmed in the third meadow of Slough Creek, upstream to a barrier falls located north of the Yellowstone National Park boundary. Currently, there are not natural barriers in place to prevent rainbow trout and brook trout, currently in the upper Sodebute Creek, from invading the upper Lamar River drainage. The upper Lamar River represents one of the last strongholds for fluvial and fluvial-adfluvial Yellowstone cutthroat trout in Yellowstone National Park. Genetic surveys in 2013 indicate that rainbow trout genetics are being detected further upstream than ever before. So what are we doing on the streams and the rivers? Native Fish Restoration Sites focuses on watersheds within the Madison-Gallatin River drainage for West Slope cutthroat trout and Arctic grayling, conservation in the Yellowstone River drainage for Yellowstone cutthroat trout conservation. Well, yeah, West Slope cutthroat trout conservation in the Madison-Gallatin River drainage includes areas in the Specimen and Grayling Creek drainages in the Goose Lake complex. Specimen Creek is located in the northwestern portion of the park, the tributary of the Gallatin River. Fish were removed from High Lake in 2006 using an approved USDA pesticide, Rotenone. In 2008, a wooden barrier that you see here was constructed on the lower portion of the East Fork of Specimen Creek to prevent the upstream movement of non-native fish and to isolate headwater populations. In 2008 and 2009, fish were removed from the East Fork Specimen Creek using two separate pesticide treatments. Using remote site incubators, West Slope cutthroat trout were restocked in the High Lake in 2007 and 2009, in East Fork Specimen Creek in 10 and 12. Grayling Creek is located in the northwest portion of the park. It is a tributary to the Hebgen Lake. Conservation actions include modifying an existing waterfall, removing non-native fish and reintroducing native species, the West Slope and the Arctic Grayling. Conservation actions included this modification of natural waterfall to completely prevent upstream movement of non-native fish, primarily brown trout and rainbow trout. This barrier was completed in 2013. Conservation actions include reintroducing West Slope cutthroat trout and Arctic Grayling. During August of 2013, the upper portion of the Grayling Creek was treated with pesticide to remove all fish species. Multiple agencies participated in this project, including Turner Enterprises, Montana Fish, Wildlife and Parks, U.S. Forest Service, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. A second treatment is anticipated for this year. The Goose Lake complex consists of three lakes on the west side of the Firehole River. Non-native rainbow trout were removed from these lakes in 2011. The lakes will be stocked with West Slope and used as a brood source for future restoration efforts. We're currently working with Sun Ranch, Montana Fish, Wildlife and Parks, and the U.S. Forest Service to develop a brood source for West Slope. So let's move over to the Lamar River drainage. In 2013, the falls of Icebox Canyon was altered to make it a complete barrier to upstream fish migration, to protect the area from further rainbow trout invasion. Barrier design for Slough Creek was completed in 2014. Initial barrier designs for Upper Lamar River were completed in 2014. Alterations to the falls in Icebox Canyon were completed in 2013 by the National Park Service and the Forest Service. Rainbow trout will no longer be able to migrate into Slough Creek from the Lamar River. Final barrier design for Lower Slough Creek. The design will create a small waterfall to prevent rainbow trout and Yellowstone cutthroat trout, rainbow trout hybrids from entering Upper Slough Creek. We believe we'll construct this in 2015. Flint Creek Cascade on the Lamar River. This is one possible location for construction of a barrier to prevent rainbow trout and hybrids from entering the Upper Lamar drainage. Several barrier types are being considered. Yellowstone National Park fisheries crews are doing electrofishing in the Lamar River using a John boat mounted electrofishing equipment. Fish are stunned by the electric current, and crews can selectively remove rainbow trout and hybrids while releasing Yellowstone cutthroat trout unharmed. Crews also monitor the river for brown trout. This technique, along with raft electrofishing, is being used in Slough Creek to remove rainbow trout and hybrids. Yellowstone National Park fishery crews are doing the same things on the Lamar River using the John boat and mounted electrofishing equipment. Elk, Lost, and Yancey Creeks make up the Elk Creek complex. Historically fishless, Lost Creek stocked with brook trout in 1942. Source of brook trout in the Yellowstone River and closest downstream source are brook trout on the Lamar River. Natural barrier to upstream movement exists. We treated this area with fish toxicant Rotenone in 2012 and 2013 to remove the brook trout. The green tint that you see in this picture is used to determine the proper amount of Rotenone to be used. Final treatment is scheduled for 2014. Stocking with Yellowstone cutthroat trout planned for late 14 or 15. Angling regulation changes in recent years have moved to protect native fish, while allowing more liberal harvest of non-natives. Current regulations in the Lamar River drainage call for catch and release of all Yellowstone cutthroat trout. If it has a red or orange slash, put it back. And removal of all rainbow trout and brook trout is required. We will continue through this program with adaptive management, seeing how we're doing, where we're having successes, where we're not as successful as we thought we were going to be, with the intention of restoring as many streams as possible within Yellowstone and lakes within Yellowstone to its native condition. Thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to take questions. I also have with me tonight Todd Poole, who is a fisheries biologist in Yellowstone. So you can stump the chump, and Todd can to help answer questions. So if we have questions, we'd be happy to take some time to answer those. Part of the lake, and we put them back in, return the nutrients to the lake. Yes?
Have you thought about taking those lake trout and selling them and making money off of them to pay for your harvesting?
You know, actually, well, I'll give you two answers to that. The first answer is, have we thought about it? Yes. But the commercial use of animals that would come out of a national park is prohibited. It's against the policies of the National Park Service. But when we did think about it, we looked at it long enough at least to know that it's really not economically feasible or viable to take them out because of the length of transportation, the requirements that we would have in terms of trying to keep the fish cool, et cetera. We didn't believe it was economically possible. But even if it was, we probably would not because it is against the policies in terms of commercial exploitation of that sort of a resource. Even though it's non-native. Yes? You still have all the same problems in terms of how do you process the fish and move the fish out. It's not economically feasible. Yes?
How many of the lake trout are tagged and released back into the lake alive or dead?
We had a mark capture study this year, and Todd helped me out with the number that we take.
Yeah, this year we tagged 2,400, released them back into the lake, and then we actually recaptured over half of those by our netting program, which kind of points to the effectiveness of the netting this past year, especially. We handled this fish pretty well. So, yeah.
And basically, we're doing that to try to determine the populations of fish in the lake. Next, under a lot of hands. Yes?
Does the program stop at park boundaries or do you go outside of the park? Is that super?
So far, it's stopping at the park boundary. We believe that if we can deal with the barriers, grading the barriers, and remove fish, we have a chance of success. I don't think we're opposed where it would be, we get help from Fish and Wildlife Service, Forest Service, and certainly with Montana. Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, and if there were places that we could cooperate with them outside the park, I'm sure we would look at doing that. Yes?
As far as the angler's annual permit fees, that's got to be pretty substantial. How much of that would go into, say, this, since it's high priority, the lake trout eradication program? Do you use a lot more of those fees for that program?
I believe we actually generate, I believe, somewhere around $800,000 in fish fees in terms of fishing permits, and I would tell you without a doubt the majority of that goes back. We have to pay for the program, we have to pay for printing, we have to pay for a lot of things out of it, but the vast majority goes back right into the fish conservation program. Yes?
You mentioned that the bears were starting to feed on the elk as their primary source.
We don't know, and what I said is there are signs that may be happening. I actually have a bumper sticker in my office that says "Lake trout kill elk." wasn't produced by studies that were done show there are indications that they may be shifting, you know, the food source from trout to elk. What the total impact of that is, I don't think we know yet. Yes?
You said that every fish species has its advocates. Do you have visitors who come to the park specifically to fish for lake trout and mm-hmm.
Yes. We have people who think it's a tremendous sport fishing opportunity. It's a wonderful game fish, and they are opposed to us, to our removal of lake trout from Lake Trout. I gotta move it. I can't, my glasses aren't gonna help us a lot. So, sure. Up here.
Do you have any comments on the current efforts to open the rivers to boating?
Sure. you know, I had actually a conversation today with some congressional staff, and the question I asked them is, tell me how opening the waters of Yellowstone to paddling benefits Yellowstone National Park, or provides for the protection of Yellowstone National Park. And there was a long pause on the other end of the phone. My comments are is I understand that forbidden waters are waters that many paddlers would like to have the opportunity to be on. However, what I don't think the paddling community that initially advocated for this understood, that we just can't open that discussion to kayakers or to pack rafters. If we open that discussion, you have as much chance of looking at multicolored inner tubes of families or a group of fraternity brothers or whatever floating down the Firehole River as you have as a kayaker going down the Black Canyon and the Yellowstone. You could have drift boats in the Lamar River. You could have drift boats on the Firehole River. It's a much bigger question than kayaking or pack rafting on rivers in Yellowstone. I believe there are some places that need to be protected. I think it's a bill that's been designed for a very small minority of users, and it excludes the wishes of the majority. The bill gives us 3 years to put a new rule in place. If we don't have it in place, we cannot enforce any rule, and all waters in Yellowstone will be open to paddling. I think it's a bad rule. We're doing everything we can do to fight it. Any help you would like to give us, we're welcome to take. Excellent points. The Congressional Budget Office has estimated that it will cost over $3 million to complete the study, and it would cost over $500,000 a year for us to manage the use if it were allowed. Both money that I know we don't have. Other questions? Yes, right here.
Is there any prospect?
You know, I think the answer is no with what we know right now. I believe that no one believes that we can eliminate lake trout, you know, with current technology and what we know now. But we do think we can drive them down to a level that will not have the kind of impact on the reproduction, recruitment, and the Yellowstone cutthroat trout population. I think we're in this for a long haul. Yes.
Is there any impact on climate change? How
I think it's, I would best say that's an ongoing effort. We are certainly looking at the effects of climate change. Just sort of anecdotally, you know, it's not that Yellowstone's a lot hotter in terms of warm temperatures so far based on climate change, but we have 70 less days in the last 30 years where the temperature goes below freezing. So the colder, it's not as cold in Yellowstone, more than it's heating up. But we do have a branch of physical sciences, and climate change is one of their highest priorities in terms of what we're trying to look at. And we have, in some cases, well over 100 years of data, you know, that we can look at. The interesting thing about climate change is when you look at a 30-year average, the 30-year average starts to change over time. So what we're looking at today, you know, may, you know, this winter might be a normal winter, or a little above normal for snowfall and water content. But if you compared it to a 30-year period 30 years ago, it may not be. So it's the whole process is getting our attention. We believe it's one of the major issues that has the potential to affect the whole ecosystem. Is there a question up there?
Yeah.
Yes.
I may be using the wrong term, but electrolysis or that method for killing the age of the pride and spawning medicine. I understand that's been used, I think either Swan Lake or Five Head Lake was a pretty good success. And if the park Yellowstone are thinking about implementing that procedure, either this coming season or season thereafter?
Actually, the answer is yes. The Yellowstone, I think at MSU, they developed, and I'll call it, let's just say if you had this section over here, about half this section, there's a call it a mat, but that you would put in. They originally, it was tried with sort of a simple mat that the electricity went through to try to kill the embryos or the, but what we've done now, or what they've done is I understand they've actually attached tentacles to this that actually get down into the substrate. And the success with that so far is very, very promising about the ability to have, to basically wipe out the embryos in those areas that we have identified for spawning areas. So we intend to try it, I believe, this fall to see, excuse me?
No, yeah, I would just say that the project you're describing is actually is a collaborative study between work on Swan Lake and on Yellowstone Lake. The government shutdown had a little bit of an effect of our ability to work on Yellowstone Lake last fall, but all that equipment now is coming out to Yellowstone Lake this coming year and in the future years. But yeah, it's really, really neat to see that those results come up.
You know, we hope that's one of the ways that we can reduce the recruitment substantially. And so we can reduce the amount of suppression netting that we have to do. Other questions here?
Comment and then question, if I may. As a former whitewater guy, I worked for several years doing that, and mostly on the Rio Grande. We never went out on a trip without having to rescue some underprepared part that first rapid they flipped. And there's some much bigger rapids down there in the Black Canyon. Much more cost in dealing with that than anticipated. I wonder, as the Hatch name is such a big name in whitewater in Utah for perhaps a good reason, whether this Wyoming person has some connection that is benefited by this silliness. But I will say I've talked to some of my friends who are whitewater boating fishermen as well, and none of them like the idea of seeing drift boats on the Lamar or colorful packages of rubber going down any of the streams in the park. So how can we organize people who are interested in participating? Do you have a contact number or website or something that we can do to help with this problem?
I think the best way to help with the problem is to contact your representatives, whether they be the congressional members of the House of Representatives or the Senate, and to express your frustration, concern for what this bill might do to, if enacted, do Yellowstone. I'm sorry, I just forgot I was going to make another point. If I remember, I'll come back to it. But I think the best thing you can do is contact your congressional representatives.
The question I have that actually has to do with the talk is, we're leaving the hybrids alone. Now, many of us feel reasonably comfortable knowing the fish knowing it's a hybrid, but we're supposed to return those. Is the logic behind them?
Well, some of you probably do have that ability. And I don't think we would be opposed to the fact if you knew it was a hybrid, if you took that fish out of circulation. But, you know, many people misidentify fish all the time in Yellowstone. You know, we'll be, you know, they'll show us a great cutthroat and we're looking at a brown or, you know, whatever. And so the knowledge you have is not universally shared. But if you have certainty that you're dealing with a hybrid, you would, I don't think you'd get any problems with us if you took that fish out. Yes.
If you allow fishing to continue in the marsh, isn't there a risk that you're going to have future problems like the lake trout problem?
If we allow fishing to continue?
Yes. Fishing is what caused the lake trout problem in the first
place. The answer is a definite maybe. I think that. You know, I tried to point out in the speech or the presentation that's a little bit of an anomaly. You know, that fishing is allowed, you know, it has been allowed within national parks and that's the only animals that we really deal. I mean, you don't throw a lasso around an elk and drag it in and have a look at it and let it go. And so the answer to your question is I don't know what we do in some of the waters about the non-native species that have taken them over. Coming up out of Hepkin Lake, there is no way that we can stop the non-natives that are in Hepkin Lake from coming up from Madison and up, you know, a portion of the Firehole and up to the Gibbon Falls. You know, that is going to be happening whether we fish or not. One of the things I'm looking for is fishing to actually help us remove some of the non-natives and streams that are very difficult to control in any other way. I think the question you pose is a good one, but I think the culture of our society today, I don't think you're going to see fishing not being allowed within the national parks. And what I was going to say is that two major groups up here, the American Whitewater has withdrawn support for the paddling legislation, and American Rivers is now opposing the legislation, paddling. Yes.
One more question. Did the little more adult trout haven't make a dent in the juvenile lake trout at all? Or do they?
No, not to our knowledge.
Kids aren't overlapping enough.
To our knowledge, that Todd helped me, but to our knowledge, cutthroat trout don't prey on juvenile lake trout. Bummer. Yes.
Lake trout are one endangered species. Changing of the ecosystem such that eventually these native fish cannot survive if we keep either fishing or introducing stuff that people are not aware of then introducing the currents. Meaning boats and fishing gear and all this stuff, that could have a significant effect on the ecology of the lakes.
Aquatic invasives are of incredible concern to us. We do require that anyone who puts a boat into Yellowstone Lake have that boat inspected. You know, that we do require, you know, in many cases after inspection for that boat to be cleaned. But it is something we are critically worried about is what might come into this park, you know, from other places through. And you can extend that to paddle. You can extend that to, you know, where's that kayak been? Where's that pack raft been? You know, whatever. And bringing it into the park. So it's something that we work on diligently. We've been helped by the Yellowstone Park Foundation by funding our aquatic invasive species work that we do to keep those out. But it's a constant concern, without a doubt. Yes?
How much success do you have with our program?
I think a lot of success. I think we see it as a very effective tool. It's used not only by us, but it's used by most states that surround us.
I didn't work at all in Davis Lake, and it didn't work very well in Cherry Creek.
Let me have my fisheries biologist give a better answer than I just gave you, apparently. Todd, success or growth? No.
Yeah. I guess the examples that you're talking about there, it's not quite correct, I guess I would say. Rotenone actually worked very, very well in Cherry Creek. West Slope cutthroat trout have been reintroduced to that giant watershed right nearby here in Montana, and it's a huge success story. And within Yellowstone, we work very closely with Montana FWP biologists, and Gallup National Forest folks, and so on. We work hand in hand doing this kind of work in part with these biologists who are all very good, they're experts in this field. But just to maybe to go back to what you asked, rotenone is a chemical that's used to remove non-native or exotic fish from streams and rivers, small streams. And it's been used for a long, long time by fish biologists. And what's nice about it now is that the formulation that we use in Yellowstone now for all our work is much different than the original rotenone that was used decades ago. That you maybe if you look back through history, you'll see. You read more stories about it. Google things up, you see bad things written about it. It's not the same. It's not the same at all. We're having great success with it. We've already restored West Little Cutthroat Trout to Specimen Creek. We're working on Grayling Creek now. It's a beautiful remote watershed that we'll have native species back into here in the next few years. And it's really the only way that you can restore a native to a watershed like that. There's no other way to remove all the non-native fish or island fish completely. You know what I'm saying? And so we're lucky to actually have that tool.
I would just add, go back to the first part of what I talked about. Everything in Yellowstone is controversial. And the use of rotenone by some is very controversial. But we see it as the most effective tool that we have. Other questions? And if I can't see you, just yes.
There are other species that could be of concern that are aquatic, amphibians and things like that. Fish were introduced to artificial streams that are very abundant with amphibians, the sort of species that are over there. Are there efforts potentially in the future that would possibly increase those aquatic species? Not beyond fish form, but they are reduced.
My answer would be those species would be under the same policies that we're dealing with the native fish on. If we know of areas that had species of animals that are no longer there, that we have the ability to put back and to recreate that system, we will look at doing that. I can't tell you that there's any on the boards right now, but the policy doesn't change in terms of the direction we have in terms of trying to recreate those systems.